Hi, Jim Frankenfield here with a math video for the website jamesfrankenfield.com. It's been about a year since I made any videos, and I have some a backlog of few I'd like to make soon. But today I'm going to do one that just jumped out at me because it's an iterated function, which I think was the last video I did about a year ago, was on iterated functions. You might want to go back and take a review of that, of how iterated functions work and how we use cobweb plots. You might be able to follow this anyway, but that will give you a little more insight. This came to my attention. The reason I'm going to do this is it jumped out at me on another channel by Michael Penn. I don't think I can put a link to his video in mine, but I'll put it in the description below and in any link on my website. Let me show you on the screen his channel, his popular math channel, although a lot of what he does is a little more advanced than what I do and a little more theoretical. And this is an iterated sine function that he approaches in a very analytical method without using any kind of plotting or graphical interpretation. I'm going to take the same iterated function and I'm going to look at it graphically and not do all of that analysis. So it's just two different ways of approaching the same problem. But you may want to take a look at his method and his approach and check that out. And that's how I arrived at this problem. That's where I got the motivation to do this from. So what he had written there, let me turn the light on here. Got less than ideal lighting here right now in this studio. This is the problem as he posed it. It's the fundamental function to iterate. He started with just sine x. So he took sine x and then he started putting that kind of seed function into an iteration that has the pi over 2 in it. I'm going to iterate the function pi over 2 times sine of x, and I'm going to put that into pi over 2 sine of it, and I'm going to take pi over 2 times sine of that, and I'm going to keep iterating, which means that I have a pi over 2 out in the front. So if you watch his video, his graph will have a y coordinate of 1, my y coordinate will be pi over 2. But this is just a multiple of the same function that he analyzed. So let's take a look at this, and let's first look at the function on Desmos. Okay, so here we have the sine function, and remember from our iterated functions video that if we take the y equals x diagonal line, we can find the fixed points where the function crosses that. So if I take a 0, fixed points are where I get the same thing back. So f of x is equal to x. And this is certainly going to happen when x equals 0. I get 0 back. When x is pi over 2, I get pi over 2 back. I put it back in, I get pi over 2 again. It just is a fixed point. And minus pi over 2 will give me minus pi over 2. And you can verify that. This is periodic, so actually n times pi will give me 0. It's not truly a fixed point because I don't stay at pi. I go back to 0 in one jump. It's an eventually fixed point. But any multiple of pi will give me 0, and I'll end up right back here at this point. And likewise, I can add 2 pi to the pi over 2. This will be 5 pi over 2. I'll get pi over 2 as an answer, and I'll end up right back here. So those are the fixed points and the eventually fixed points that jump back in one iteration. We can tell whether a fixed point attracts or repels by telling whether the slope of that line is greater than 1 or less than 1, the magnitude of the slope. So let's look at the, we could do that with the derivative, although you can see this graphically. We'll come back to the graph in a minute. F prime of x is simply going to be pi over 2 cosine x, so f prime at 0, cosine of 0 is 1, this is pi over 2. So this is, the magnitude is greater than 1, so this is going to repel. And f prime of pi over 2 or minus pi over 2 is going to be plus or minus, well, this is going to be the derivative here. Cosine of plus or minus pi over 2 is going to be 0. And so this is going to attract. It has a magnitude of less than 1. So what we can see that on the graph. Okay, up here, the slope of this line locally at this point is 0. The tangent line would be 0. And here you can see that the slope is greater than the diagonal, so it's greater than 1. So we know that this is going to repel and this is going to attract. So we can pretty much guess that the points in here, if we start here and iterate, we're going to end up at 1. But let's take a look at the cobweb plot. So here's one at 2.5. I started over here on the right. And that's just going to jump over to the left and then approach 0. We can start something in here, somewhere like 0.5 to reset. So my function is entered up here. And then I can enter a starting point, and it shows my starting point, and I can iterate. And it's going to approach 1. And if I start at something like minus 1, I'm going to approach my other fixed point down here. And if I start over here somewhere like 7, I'm going to jump back into back into this initial region. And I'm going to iterate and I'm going to get to 1. So what I've shown is that this limit for anything in here approaches 1. If I start anywhere where the value of sine is negative, let's try something like minus 2. Anywhere where the value of the function is negative, I'm going to end up approaching minus 1. Let's see, I reset it already, and that's going to go to minus 1. If I go over here to 5.5, the value of sine is negative. And so when I iterate that, I'm going to jump back to the negative part of along the diagonal, and I'm going to keep iterating, and I'm going to get to minus 1. So that's what we've done here. Let's go back to our fixed points. I didn't actually put them on here. Okay. So the black dots are the 0 fixed and ultimately fixed points. Those are my pi over 2 points, and these are my minus pi over 2 points. What I've done now is I've shown that in between, if I carry this out to the limit, I'm going to approach plus 1, or plus pi over 2 in my case. Anywhere the sine is positive, I'm going to approach that fixed point. I'm going to have a value of plus pi over 2. Anywhere where the sine function is negative, I'm going to approach negative pi over 2. And so that's everywhere in here. The points in between, I'm going to approach multiples of pi. I'm going to just go to 0 in one jump. So these intervals don't include the endpoint n pi. So we can write that, and that's what I did down here when I did it, as SGN. This is just the sine function. What Professor Penn did is he looked at these regions in between, and rather than taking a graphical approach with the cobweb plot, he actually did some analysis that involved, as I recall, a trig identity and a theorem about being increasing and bounded. So as you iterate this function starting at something like 0.5, you can see that it's going to be increasing each time. But it's also bounded, and there's a theorem that applies to that he uses. So he takes a much more analytical approach. But at the end, what he comes up with is this sine of the sine function. So we reach the same endpoint and what he calls a collapse of the iterated sine function. So if your result is the limit of infinite iterations, you get just the sine SGN or SIGN function. you could say it collapses to, the whole iteration process collapses to a simple function there. Do one last thing here, which is you can iterate things easily on, let me take these off for now. Just go back to the sine function. On Desmos, it's not very hard to iterate these things. So here's my function, and I'm going to just take that function and plug it into itself by copying and pasting. So here I copied the function, and wherever my x was in the function, I put the whole function back in. So that's two iterations. I did that again, so I took this x and I replaced it with the function, and that's three iterations. Then I took the three iterations and plugged it back into the three iterations, so six iterations looks like that. So you can see that the more you iterate this, the closer you're getting to this sine SGN function. So you can see it approach that, and depending on how much space you have and how far you can go before something fails to work anymore, you could keep iterating this on Desmos. Also, I should add something. When we go to this black area, could be called a basin of attraction. So when we talk about the cobweb plot, this fixed point at the top has a certain basin of attraction that attracts all the points within that basin, which includes the positive area here. And it also attracts everything positive over here. And over here, it attracts all the positive regions of the sine function. And what we could call the basin of attraction for the negative one is all the places where the sine function itself is negative. The basin of attraction of the middle fixed point, which isn't an attractor at all, but it doesn't attract all of the other zero points. So when we graph this, what we're really graphing with this SGN function, the black line, is the basin of attraction, the fixed point. Let me go back and put the fixed points on here, fixed and ultimately fixed points. This black fixed point attracts all the points on the black line. That's its basin of attraction. And you could say the same thing about the negative one. The zero is actually a repelling point, but it will attract anything at n pi, the points at n pi. One of the topics in iterated functions is basin of attraction for attracting points, and that's what we're really graphing here when we collapse this function. We could call it a collapse of the function, as Professor Penn did, or we could actually look at it as the basin of attraction for the iterated function and its attractor points. So that's my approach to the problem, and it's a different approach and a different method than Professor Penn used, and you might want to look at both videos, compare the methods. It's interesting to see the two approaches. His may require a little more mathematical background, and mine, I like to take the visual and graphic approach. So that's it. There you go. There's an iterated sine function, two different ways to do it. One very heavy on analysis, one much more graphical, and both have their merits, and both get you to the same endpoint. So that's it for the iterated function, and hopefully pretty soon I'll get back to some of the other videos that are not at all related to iterated functions. I have a wide variety of topics on the channel in physics and engineering as well as math, and hopefully we'll get back to adding a few more soon. Until then, I hope you enjoy the iterated functions. Bye.